Hello everyone, I am Jeff Bell, and I decided to do another one of these little videos. Seems like a lot of people that I had talked to online enjoyed the Jaws poster breakdown that I did, so I thought, what the hey, let's do another one of these, and let's do another really ridiculously complicated poster, because, you know, it wouldn't be fun if it was just a single layer and some text. So this poster is ridiculously complicated. This was, it's not the longest I've worked on a poster, but it's the most stuff done in still a reasonable amount of time that I probably have ever done on a poster. If that doesn't make any sense, I apologize. It makes sense in my head, but that's not why you're watching this, so let's keep going. So this poster I did for an independent film company called Fighting Owl Films. Great group of guys. I've done some work for them previously before this poster. This is one of their most recent films that they are actually currently, at the time of recording this, they are just starting production. Apologize, guys. I'm trying to keep up with everybody. So, for more information about those guys, definitely check out their website, fightingowlfilms.com, or check out their Facebook, facebook.com/fightingowlfilms. It's not really hard to spell. You shouldn't have any problems finding it. And keep an eye out on them. There's some awesome people, and they make some really kind of fun, cool films. So I did this poster for them. They asked me to make a movie poster, and they gave me a concept, a drawing concept. And actually, these guys are awesome, because this is the first, not the first, the most. They gave me the most content to work with when it came to the poster, which was great. Because usually when I get these projects, they don't really give me anything. They give me like, well, I have this idea. Go. And it's really hard to make a full-fledged poster, but these guys did an excellent job. They gave me a lot of content. Actually, this whole everything that you kind of see scrolling across here, all of this stuff was what they gave me, and minus I do believe these last three items here. I believe that I found these because I was going to try to do something with them, but everything else prior to that was all given to me by the client, by the guys there, and I was able to take that and kind of go from there. So let's break this down. This is the final version. This poster actually has black bars on the side of it because I designed it in a way so that way they could use it. If they'd remove these black bars, they could use it for the full art, which would also allow them to do like DVD covers, Blu-ray covers, if they released a soundtrack, if they, you know, anything that they wanted to do with the art, they could, because they weren't restricted to just a poster, basically. And plus they had so much content, you know, to give me, I didn't want to try to cram it all into a tiny little space. So these black bars didn't show up on the final poster. They actually were just there for, basically guides to show what the poster would look like. There's my guidelines on. So we shall remove those so you can see the entire full graphic. Lots of stuff to go over. So let's just start knocking these off. And as you can tell, as we go along here, there's a lot of, layers. Lots of layers. So here's the poster. It's an amazing poster. No, that's a joke. Basically, I started from the back and moved my way forward. Now, actually, I do believe I threw down the fireplace first. Now, the fireplace in this particular instance is this photograph right here. Now, if you notice, obviously, it's got some carpet still in this particular one, and the fireplace itself actually does not stretch as high as I wanted it to, because I was trying to give this look like you're looking across the room. It was a wide photograph of the room, and it was a big, tall fireplace. So what I did was I did just a really simple, basic clone job on the top part of this fireplace. Now, obviously, I didn't do a real good job at hiding these repeating stones here to make it look like it was a different fireplace, bricks going up. I tried a little bit, but obviously this brick and this brick and this brick are all the same, and this one are the same. You can really see it once I point it out, but I knew that the title of the film was going to end up going up here, and there was going to be a lot of other texture work on it, so I didn't really care that much about it repeating over and over and over again. So basically what I did, there's still a ton of layers with inside here. Let's just knock all of this off, because there's so many things to go over. Oh my goodness. Look at all that. I need that. Okay, so what we got here is we got the fireplace. And what I got out of the fireplace was I did some very, very minor edge refinement, because there was just a couple little spots here from this photo that I wanted to make sure the edges blended, especially because of the color background for the wall that I was going to do for it. So I went back through and kind of touched them up, just trying to kind of keep the look of the garland on the side there. What I did also, besides stretching the top part of the fireplace, I actually also stretched this part of the fireplace. If you look at here again, you can you can see that there was obviously like a glass case for the fire to keep the fire out, and I wanted to get rid of that. And this window, because the whole concept of the poster was that the creature was actually going to be crawling itself out of the fireplace. Now, I tried keeping it this opening, however, it was too tight of an opening. The creature wouldn't have looked right coming out of the fireplace. It didn't look realistic enough, because the creature basically would have ended up having to contort its body, and it wouldn't have looked right. So what I did, besides stretching this top part out, I actually stretched this part out as well. And again, I applied the exact same thing, where I basically just repeated a portion of the fireplace up, and then I completely blackened this out entirely, just to get rid of the reflection in the wind or in the fireplace there. And then I just kind of, you know, fixed this, so this part was actually behind the decorations, as you see that now. So all together, I basically took this fireplace and I stretched it more. And I don't really necessarily think that's an entirely realistic size for a fireplace, but you know what? It doesn't matter. It's a mystical creature coming out of the fireplace. If you're worried about the size of the fireplace and not the mystical creature coming out of it, there's some issues. So I took that. What I did is, and on top of that, I started looking into some, just to try to dirty up the fireplace a little bit, because I like this grungy kind of dirty style for some of these posters. So just to try to make this fireplace look a little more used, I kind of just used a brush tool and just added some kind of dark dirtiness to it to give it kind of a soot, like kind of a darker effect. After that, I'll get onto those later. What I did is that we wanted the snow globe, because snow globes are cool. Not as cool as fezzes, but they are still cool. Added the snow globe above here onto the fireplace to make it look like, oh my goodness, does anybody know why this keeps doing this? This is so annoying. Happens all the time. We're just gonna put that down there. So we added the snow globe on top of the fireplace, just to add it, because it was part of the original sketch concept art that they gave me. So I wanted to kind of just keep that, because I thought that was cool. Plus, again, they sent me a really nice high-res photo of snow globe, so I'm like, I'm gonna use that. So I used it. So I worked it in here and just did a little mask layer on there just to hide it behind the snow, like it's sitting just like the rest of it, and then just some minor color adjustments. Now, I tried my hardest to make everything match better before I put the textures on it, just so it was more cohesive after the textures were put on, but there is occasionally some spots that don't entirely blend well as we go along. So basically, I had the fireplace. Now, I figured after the fireplace, why not? Let's just start working on the wall. Let's just start doing the stuff behind the wall. Now, there's a lot of portions of this too. So what I did is I found this texture online, just this green texture. I didn't intend to use the green initially, but I ended up liking it once I got it in. So what this really is obviously it's just two different, it's just two copies of the exact same texture. This is one side, that's the other side, through behind the fireplace. Now that's, it doesn't look entirely realistic. So what I did was I wanted to add in the floor and the trim to it. So the floor and the trim, along with some additional content. Originally, the picture of the fireplace had this carpet in it. However, they also gave me this really cool wooden, I think this is like a, almost like a gym floor, but it still works. It still looks okay. It still works for the house, because this house could easily just have wooden floors. That's awesome. So I used that in this to butt up against the edge. Now, because I added the wall here and then this, obviously the floor just basically ends, trying to make it proportionate to how deep perhaps this fireplace actually is, or how far away from the wall it's sticking. So what I did is I'm like, well, I know I need trim. I need trim, because in my head at this point in the stage, I didn't realize I was going to end up blocking basically all of this, but it's still there. So I found online, not that one, actually, was it this one? This one, look at that, baseboard, an actual photo of baseboard, nice, good, high res quality. I basically cropped out the white, left the photo as it is. However, I did color it. Now, coloring it, not that difficult. Just basically, I threw on a separate layer on here, which obviously I merged and did not keep separate. Awesome, Jeff. Just to give it a more wood grain or wood look, instead of it just being so white, because this was too white for the photograph, I wanted to kind of give it a little more earthly tone. So, and as you can see, the photograph itself is actually not that large. And I also took the original photo here, and honestly, I just stretched it both ways. This is not repeating at all. I'm sure you actually can't see it because of the nice lines of the actual base mold, and because we weren't using this really close to the camera, it was okay to actually just stretch the right side, stretch the left side, and make it elongate out. Worked fine. As you can see in here, when it gets to this size, even at 100% of the photograph right now, it just looks like baseboard. There's nothing really you need to worry about for that. So, we have our floor, our wall, and our baseboard. Looking pretty good. I wanted to, because it's way too bright here, there's no way this part of the wall would be that bright when it's that close to the edge of the fireplace, neither side. So, what I kind of did is I just went through and I started kind of darkening up both sides of the wall just to give it some depth, almost looking like there's might be maybe like a light up here somewhere that's shining on it. And then, as well as adding those, I just kind of darkened it a little bit more up in the corner, and also adding a shadow to the side. So now, once I added the shadow to the side, now you get the effect that there's possibly a light somewhere over here behind the camera, and you're getting the shadow of this. So it's actually a little bit farther over here, shining this way to get this shadow effect. Again, just a little something creative, something different for it. And the nice thing with this fireplace was there's really no direct shadow anywhere on anything. Everything's very, very soft, so you could kind of make your own shadows, which was really, really nice and really, really handy. I gotta like that. So, at this stage, because now that I have the wood floor in and all that as well, also I did add a little bit of a shadow, very, 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 very faintly. To the underside of the trim, just to make it look like it is actually resting upon the wooden floor. Without that little bit of a shadow, the trim just looks a little off. It looks too perfect. So by doing that, it actually gives it just enough of a break. Again, from back here, it's faint. It's not very predominant, but it is just enough, and it helps just bring the whole thing together. And then I started darkening this whole side a lot more, just because, again, before this, it's way too bright for what this would actually be, and this just kind of helps kind of bring a lot of the different layers together to try to make them all look cohesive. So, after that, I have the walls done. So at this point, the wall is technically done. I do actually have a window, so let me take that back. The wall is not done. What we also have is we have the window here. Now the window is handful, as you can see as I'm scrolling down there, a handful of portions. So what they got is we got this nice little windowsill looking out, kind of inside, could be outside, it's kind of hard to tell, but it nice little window, so I wanted to use that, so we use the window. So plop the window in. Now, because we're punching a hole in it and this is supposed to be taking place at night, we obviously don't want to see the wall, so we just added a dark. So now that's supposed to be outside, but it is too dark personally. It's just black. There's nothing outside, and I wanted there to be at least some sort of life out here. And because we're at Christmas time, what I decided is, we'll just add some snow. Now, again, from this from this point of view, it looks really goofy. It doesn't really look like snow at all, but from back here, it just gives a little bit of something going on out there. Now, maybe it's not snow, maybe it's a tree outside, maybe it's, there's a handful of different things that this potentially could be. And I did also go through and I added frost. Now, again, when it's all uncolored like this, it looks goofy, but once the textures are on, this actually looks really good. And this was all just done by hand. I just had a brush. I one of my hundreds and hundreds of brushes that I collected over time here, and just kind of went through. And one of them is like, I think it's one of the grunge brushes down here that actually would give this random kind of texture as you would work it and go along. And I just kind of just painted down and then painted down and over, and then did the same thing and just by hand, so that way nothing was the same. There was no frost that looked identical, which was what I was going for. So after I had that done, I realized that the way that this window is sitting in the wall, it, you know, in a real house, since we did the trim down here, we would obviously want to have like a windowsill trim on here. Plus, again, in the original photograph, it kind of had something similar. So I basically, and you can see all the trim here, had to put it in its own sub-sub folder. This is all the trim that was added to it later on. Now, there's a lot of steps in this guy here. That is just one side. We won't do them all because that would be just tedious. So what I did is, going back to this one again, we're using one piece of photograph. As you can see, here's that little knot right there. That's in that one. And I did the same thing as I did for the trim. I actually just took that same single photograph and stretched it. Now, when you stretched it, these pre-cut corners, originally I was thinking, oh well, those corners will be perfect, those will line up. Yeah, they didn't. They stretched way too far, or they weren't the right angle for what I was looking for. So basically I had to remake all of the corner pieces. So what I did is I plopped this side on, and again, this is the same thing for all sides. I'm not gonna go through them all. And just going through layer by layer, these are just chunks of color. As you can see, that's a solid brown color, so that's probably what I did for this down here. And all I'm doing is I'm just telling it to, you know, go to that bottom one. Obviously, that's what it looked like beforehand, and that's what it looked like afterwards. So, and one by one, what I actually did here is we just did a multiply on it, so that way it took it from that light, way too light color to a darker tone that actually kind of matched the rest of the wood that's in the area here. And basically just did that. And what I actually did just to make it look a little different was I did kind of get rid of that knot up here, so that way it didn't look like it was all the same chunk of wood. And then just kind of rinse and repeat with everything else here. I just realized that that is not supposed to be like that. There we go. And just to give the edges a little, again with the trim, I just gave it a little bit of a shadow going down that line there, just so that way it did look like there was two separate pieces butting up against each other and not just one solid mass of wood. So that's the windowsill. There is some little minor things. At this point, I kind of started playing around with adding some lights and reflection. This was something I did later on, not initially at this stage, but because there's all these Christmas lights on the fireplace here, I realized that I wanted it to actually have some kind of an effect. Hold on, where's it at? Where's it at? That one. I figured that because these lights are so close to it, it would actually be casting a little bit of a glow on the side of the wood here. So again, just a tiny little detail to make it look more realistic. I did actually go back and just added another layer, which is a very, very soft white brush, and just did it at a very low opacity just to kind of give it a little bit of a glow. You don't want to overdo it. If you overdid it, you know, obviously this is going to be way, way overkill if you just did it like that's actually too much, because that light is not, if the light was directly on top of it, that might work, but that's too much. You just want that very, very subtle, very, very much. I always like to use the opacity lower at, you know, probably like 25 or so when doing this, because it's easier to do it a couple times and layered on top of each other at different spots here than to just do it at 100% and hope that looked good. So I added that effect, and actually I did the exact same effect, since we're finishing on the window, I did the exact same effect on the fireplace. So we shall go back to the fireplace. That's what these effects were. Please forgive me, I do not know where all of these are turning on. Oh, okay, this is actually a shadow I added later on for the Christmas tree. It's gonna go here. And that's a little more shadowing on the left-hand side. Not sure why I lightened it. That's goofy. And just a little more of a shadow at the top there. So just to help, yeah, just to help give it a little bit more effect. And then just a couple more little pieces of shadowing. There's a lot of layers. Oh, so yeah. So after I did the fireplace, again, the same thing as the trim here, I actually added some shadowing to the fireplace bottom here, because obviously the brick isn't even, and I purposely made it look like that because nothing is perfectly straight. There is no sharp lines in the world, and when you have a sharp line, that's when It just looks fake. And actually, technically, this wood is almost a little bit too straight. It probably could have used a little bit of imperfections, but there's a couch that sits here, so I didn't bother with that. Plus, it's on the side, and I knew that was going to be cut off with the poster. So all this shadow is all added later on. Again, doing the same thing that I did kind of up here, which was just grab out a black brush, throw it at a lower opacity, and kind of just I always like to go really, really no hardness at all, and then kind of do like a larger size, perhaps about like that or so. And what that would do is it allows you to, if we just drop this down to 25%, it will allow you to kind of just paint in a darker shadow kind of slowly, and you can kind of figure out, well, where's the light coming from? And okay, I can just kind of keep slowly building that shadow up. And when you kind of slowly, you can slowly see where the light's coming from. And you can always go to a slightly, you can go to a higher opacity if you wish to, and just make it be just to kind of finalize it and cement in just the real darkness of it. But just to get that. So I mean, that's, you go from here to that, and that's not the best down here, but like that right there showing kind of the same direction. You want to make sure that all your light sources are going the same direction, otherwise you're going to start noticing there's some issues. So we will get rid of that because I like my original one better. That's better. And then, okay, so now we have the wall, we have the fireplace, and we have the window. We're getting there. We're about halfway there, I promise. So, the next thing would have been the Christmas tree was the next thing I did, and all the presents. Now, there's a lot of different spots here. I kept adding presents as we went along, and obviously the presents, their coloring isn't the world's best because the resolution for some of these present photos that I found online were just terrible. Because I only had a couple here that I was given that were the right angle. Because that's the other key thing you got to look at is that is the perspective of these photographs of, so like this one worked. It did need a little tweaking just to get it be a little more the perspective in right. These presents were there originally in the original photographs, so everything had to match these presents in quality and coloring and in size without it looking way too over the top. So the Christmas tree worked the exact same way as the fireplace. Not a whole lot I had to do for the tree. One of the major things, just I had to do some darkening of the edges because this is the original one, and you can see the cutout kind of came out a little weird just because of the way that the Christmas tree photo was originally taken. So went back through the whole thing and darkened the edges so that way they kind of blended a little better with the background. Again, just a little subtle thing, and then just some minor tweaks to the actual entire photograph itself of the tree. And then the same thing as what we did here for the fireplace was I went back over the entire Christmas tree light bulbs, yes, practically every single one of them, and added this slight halo to the lights just because I wanted the lights to glow. And it's not something that a normal camera is going to catch, but I wanted it in the photograph. And same thing as before, basically took a small paintbrush, only went to about I think like 35 or 40% opacity, and kept the paintbrush very close to the size of the light, not much bigger than maybe about that or so. And basically, we just clicked on one. I don't have any one that I missed. I believe I did them all. Okay, so like this one actually. So if we went down to about 40%, and then we just went like boop, like that. That's it. That's all it was. It's just very subtle, just enough to kind of highlight the light and give it a little bit of glow and make it look a little more realistic. So did that on the entire Christmas tree, and there's some very minor, just kind of edge work and tweaking and colorizing. And the top Christmas tree, the actual star here, got a little goofy in the original photograph, so we kind of just straightened it. And I don't know, we're talking like there's multiple people here. It's just me. Don't talk to myself at all, I promise. We did it again. No, so I did the just kind of straightened out the Christmas tree star a little bit, just so that way there's a little more cleaner lines since it was might still be in the photograph depending upon just how this worked. Then underneath it's just tons and tons and tons of presents. There's a lot of presents underneath here actually, and I kept adding presents and just kept adding them and adding them and adding them. There's a lot here. And actually, this is this is one of those things where I actually spent a lot of time getting like a really good correct shadow for this Christmas tree base here, and then realize, you know what, I'm just going to put presents all over in front of it, so that way you can't see really a good, you know, you can't see the real well done shadow that I added to it, but meh, doesn't matter. So again, like this, like I said, for the, like I said, with the tree base, or the, sorry, the fireplace, and then the base trim here, just the shadows, again, trying to keep that same shadow direction for everything, figuring that this box would actually be casting a shadow on these boxes and all that stuff. And again, the lighting is not real well in here, but there's going to be tons of textures on this, and it'll all blend together. So that is truthfully, and then these are just more. I kept adding more and more presents, because originally I believe that was all the presents I had, and I just wanted to make it look like a classic Christmas, you know, scene where there's just tons of presents all over the place. So at this point, I realized there was something that was just missing over here. The original sketch didn't have anything over there but Christmas presents. So I'm like, you know, but this is just way too empty. If there's a nice tree, the balance is off. It just felt off. The tree is about the same height as the window, and there's a lot of stuff here, and there's nothing here, and I figured somebody would have something. So I basically went online, and I don't know if I have the photo in here. I do not. I found a photo of a couch. Plain and simple. Basically, I just went online, found a just Googled couch. Nothing really complicated here. Found one that was kind of in the right perspective. The main thing was that because of the way that the fireplace is in the photograph, everything was based upon the fireplace. The way that the edge here is coming to the right and the edge here is coming to the left meant that this photo of the couch had to actually be like this. It had to be going that same direction, otherwise it would look goofy, because the perspective would be entirely off and you would easily notice that there's something weird with the couch. So that's the photo of the couch that I got. Had it at the angle, had to do some very minor tweaking to it, just so that way it was going the right direction. It was the right height, and that was kind of a goofy area trying to figure out the right height for this couch. And then, as always, I just went back through and added a darker shadow and added its shadowing on the wall here some more. And again, at this point, if you realize that trim work that I spent so much time working on and adding shadow, yeah, you basically cannot even see it. If you saw the poster at the start, you probably didn't even realize I did the trim work. It wasn't until I hit all this stuff that you realize it was even there. And then just adding some darker shadows on the side. And then here's another one, just like I did for up here with this Christmas bulb. I realized that because this thing is so close and it's so bright, that it would actually be shining on the side of the couch. So I just added a light spill on it, so that way what it would do is it would be there, just enough of a light glowing on it. And then I did an overall adjustment, because this was way too bright of a couch to be in this photograph. So it just darkened the whole thing and left the halo on it. It's just so it was a little more light, again, making it look like it's all in the same scene. So at this point, basically the entire poster is done, art-wise, except for the creature that'd be coming out of the center. So here's the final creature. And the creature, again, has a lot, actually, of different layers. Pretty much sure all these are on, so we just turn them all back off. Okay, so here is the initial creature design costume. This is not final at all. Please do not assume this is any kind of quality or version quality of their work. Their work is really, really good. This is just a really, really early costume test that would totally works for what we were doing. So took the original creature and realized, because of the way he's coming out, it kind of works, but it doesn't entirely for the way he needs to be coming out. So basically cut him down into multiple pieces. His legs are one, because I wanted his foot to be up here on this part, and then his foot to be crushing this present, which is obviously it's the same type of paper as this present. So I wanted to make it look like this was a grouping of presents that he's stomping his feet on. So we did I did the legs, and then added I wanted his one hand to be here, and then I wanted his other hand to be up there, and then I wanted just his horns, because obviously the rest of the costume wasn't finalized and I didn't want it to be showing in the poster. Then I wanted to make sure it was kind of, I wanted it to be like, you don't entirely know what this creature is, you don't really know how big he is, but it's coming out of the fireplace. So by doing this, there is a little bit of a contortion to it, which just adds to the kind of creepiness of them, so you don't really know what's coming out. But that's, again, that's the point. And then so just some kind of tweaking and readjustment of the horns, taking it from this one, and I kind of recolored them a little bit and kind of reportioned them. Just it's just very subtle, as you can see, it's very subtle what I did there, but just enough to change it a little bit. And then added a shadow to it, because the whole thing is that he's coming out of the fireplace. So all of these guys had adjustments, very minor adjustments, but enough to help just fine-tune exactly how much of him you saw. So then I just added some shadows around here, so he's casting shadows and everything again, following that same light pattern as I did before with all this stuff, and then just adding some minor cracks. These weren't added until after I did all the textures later on, so they look a little goofy now. But I almost had this feeling like as he's coming out, he's such a presence. He's actually breaking the fireplace and he's breaking the floor as he does so. And again, these are just brushes. These are just Photoshop brushes that I'm using that are cracked Photoshop brushes that just kind of do a really good job at blending into whatever you plop them onto. And then the other little minor tweaks that I did was actually when I was adjusting his hands, which I don't think I can show you. Nope. I did take that wasn't gonna help. I kind of helped clean out because these were finger extensions just for this promo shot, and you could kind of see the edge of the extended finger. So what I did is I blended the finger in to the actual hand, and I actually pushed the joint in the hand back further on both hands, just so that way it looked a little less human. It looked a little kind of inhuman because that's a lot deeper than it should be on the normal human hand, and I didn't want it to look like a human, more or less. So did that, and then again just some more minor tweaking and adjusting to the overall creature, colorizing him a little bit more. And then originally this was as far as I went with him, and I left him exactly like that. But I realized it looked a little weird once I got the textures on it. It was kind of hard to tell where his head was. So I went back in and I added just a pair of eyes, just red glowing eyes piercing out from the dark, and I purposely made him looking at the audience just so it's almost like this is you coming into the kit or into the living room, and you spotted him coming out, and he looked up at you, and that's the exact moment that you're at. And these eyes themselves, as you can see, are a couple of different steps here. I originally was trying to find eyes online, but all the eyes I was using just weren't working. So what these are is it's just a kind of a hand-drawn little kind of eye-ish shape, and just with a very basic gradient here, just kind of going from a darker red to a little bit of a lighter red, just to kind of give it some, depth to it. And then I added an outer glow on the whole thing, so it makes the eyes look like they're glowing. Without this outer glow, it didn't look right. It looked like there was something off about the eye. So it actually helped. It also kind of makes it look like the eye is lightening up the fur right around his eye too, so it kind of continues to make the fur right. And then on top of that, because I realized that that was just kind of this weird dark, just or weird red eye, I actually added a pupil to it, and then we just duplicated and flipped him, changed the pupil a little bit, and just enough from up close, it looks kind of goofy. It looks like eyes, but it looks a little goofy. But again, what's important is what it looks like from afar and after the textures are applied, and that was perfect for what we were looking for. So now, after all of that, again, oh yes, I forgot the Christmas lights. That's just the same glow as I did before, went through all of them. So at this point, the art for the poster is actually done. That's all the art. So the poster technically is completed, just without anything additional that you want to do with it. But if you saw my Jaws video, you know that I want to do more. So I threw the title treatment on here. This was never planned. I just kind of did this just because, and it actually kind of worked really well. Like, this was a really kind of cool font, and this is just a couple different layer styles. Nothing really fancy about this. The font itself is actually called, is that called Matrix Tall? Is that the font? Look at that, Matrix Tall. Matrix Tall. Kind of an interesting font. I've actually never used it for anything and forgot I even had it. And then the layer style is, there's a handful of, yeah, you can see there's a lot of layer styles here. This was actually part of a group of layer styles that I found buried lots of different bits and pieces for everything added together, just so it kind of gives this metallic look to everything. And again, I wasn't trying to go for metallic, but with the textures applied on top of it, because the titles, if you notice, are actually underneath the textures. I do not put them above the textures, because again, just like the Jaws poster, when you throw the textures on top of it, it kind of blends everything together, makes it look a little nicer. So I just threw that on there just as a title, wasn't supposed to be permanent. It was just kind of there, and ended up leaving it there because it actually worked really well. So now on to the textures. Now here's what it looks final. So as you can see, there's actually quite a lot. I'm actually going to get rid of the ones that I didn't use just so I don't get them mixed up. As you can see, there's a ton of different stuff here that was added, because I couldn't quite find where I wanted to go with the poster. So first off, I knew I wanted to darken, or I wanted to desaturate it because it was too colorful. So this is heavily desaturated. Not heavily, but it's desaturated enough. You still have the color, but it's not as happy and chipper because this was too happy. So I did that. Then I added a vignette to it because I really wanted to hone in on the center part of the poster. You wanted your eye to look to here, basically. And as you can see, I kind of started playing around with some extra textures, some wear and tear on some of these posters. Didn't really necessarily care for the appearance of a lot of these, so I never actually used those. And but I use that one. I don't remember if I used that one. Was it bottom three? Bottom three, I didn't use those. So, and the more I got into it, the more I realized I wanted it to be even more desaturated. So this was another. This is actually just a kind of an aw. Yeah, I was gonna say it's kind of like a slightly lighter white that I just added on top of it at the color layer adjustment. So that way it again kind of desaturated it, but it kind of brightened it a little bit. Again, just trying to fine-tune some stuff. Added another a layer of vignetting down at the bottom because again I wanted to just focus more on that. Added and then on top of this, then what actually creates the final look is two final textures. This texture, which is very similar to the one that I used on the Jaws poster. It is just another kind of funky paper, kind of clothy, dirt marking thing. I've used this for so many different posters. It's amazing. Just add 75%, and then actually, I don't remember what I did for the other one. Did I just do that as a multiply? Oh yeah, it does multiply. Multiply is your friend. So by just adding that, it gave it. And again, I was gonna leave it at this, and then I was gonna put another texture on top of it, but I really liked that this one kind of gave it a more dirty look, if you will. And it almost like a halfway between a dirty, a just kind of a dirty look and almost like a sepia, like old school photograph kind of, it's the way my head works. But again, as you can see, just like the Jaws poster, once you get to this point where you're adding the textures to stuff, a lot of this stuff all just blends in really, really well, and it doesn't look off, and it doesn't look like it was separately added. Everything, which is the work in the shadows, and then adding that little glow, the halo lights around the Christmas lights, just really kind of makes everything blend together, and you start losing that this looks goofy over here. So, and I purposely, when I added this layer, I purposely made sure I blocked out his eyes because I wanted to keep the eyes as bright as possible. So once at this stage, I was done. I was happy with the way the poster looked. I was happy with how it came out. But I did know I was just kind of having fun with it at this point, and I realized I'm like, well, if we're going this aged and kind of dirty and grungy look, I do have a texture that adds lots of smudges and scratches, and then the obvious what to say about that paper fold. So almost like this was an old school poster, or like folded up flyer or something like that that's been folded and creased, and it's been sitting like that for years, and someone unfolded it, because I love that aged look. I love that style where it looks like this was a legitimate thing that someone just threw on a scanner and scanned in. And I get a huge kick out of seeing movie posters that still do that, so I always try to do that myself. And this texture is actually just exactly what you would think it is. It's basically a black and white or black and yeah basically a black and white piece of a stock art that, oops, I just messed up that is just a giant black piece of paper that had been folded and has some really cool smudges on the sides and fingerprint markings. And I use it a lot for this thing right here. And the nice thing about this is because it is black, it's a lot easier to desaturate it and add it to photographs without getting, you know, and just getting the nice kind of smudges and creases left behind. So at this stage, I liked it, but the crease was going right into the middle of our creature. And since there's not a lot of them there, you kind of lost a lot of him. So I basically just went straight dab in the middle and used a brush to hide a lot of the middle of the fold without completely getting rid of it. There's still a very subtle fold there because I just didn't want to distract it from him. But it added a lot of really kind of cool smudges. And like, this is a fingerprint right here, which it's kind of really cool. And again, there, once that texture was added on it, it really hides a lot of this stuff back here, as well as my hard worked trim. And yeah, you can't even see the trim on that side. That's how awesome it is. So at this point, the poster actually is completed, done. And then and I, like I said, at that point, I figured out I had been planning it the whole time with my my guidelines here as to where the poster was going to be, but I still like actually matting it out just to make sure that everything is falling in place. So based upon the original kind of rough concept to this, it matched it. I tried matching it as close as I could while also giving him a little bit more. So that is all for this poster. Like I said, it was really, really deep. There's a lot of layers in this one, and apologize, it was going a little longer than I expected, but there's a lot to talk about. So I hope you enjoyed watching this one. I do want to do one more of these videos that I'm actually might make into a couple of them, where I'm trying to recreate my King Kong poster. I actually sadly lost the Photoshop file to, and it's just one of my favorite posters that I've done, and I would really like to have a Photoshop version of it again. So I thought maybe I'd rebuild the entire poster and just try to recreate it and show you kind of an actual step-by-step working, like physical working of a poster. So that might be kind of fun. So if you want to see that, by all means, leave some comments, hit like, let me know, just because I want to make sure I'm doing these for more than just me, which would be nice. So, but in the meantime, if you guys want to see more of my stuff, definitely check out my website at www.randombell.com, or you can check out my DeviantArt page at which would be themovieman.deviantart.com, or you can check out my production company, which is ghosthat.net. We do awesome things. We have multiple weekly podcasts and more joining it, so definitely hit us up on iTunes. We just released our new website, which will be a little easier to find everything. You can listen to it on our website. You can also listen to it on iTunes. Subscribe to us. We have multiple shows. It's great. You'll love us. Or as always, and I'd like to do a special thanks real quick to to the guys at Fighting Owl Films, because they are awesome and they do some great work, and they let me kind of be a part of it, which is cool. So thanks, guys, for letting me break this down, and hopefully you guys enjoyed it and hopefully you learned a little something. So I'll catch you guys later. Bye-bye.